This
Today I'm going
conference
to
will now be recorded.
tell about the Jonah idiopathic arthritis. So before going in detail about the Jonah idiopathic arthritis, I want to tell what are the differences between rheumatic arthritis and rheumatoid arthritis. Is there anybody want to answer to my question? What are the differences between rheumatoid arthritis and rheumatic arthritis? Because most often in your clinical case taking during your practical examination, you may get a case with arthritis. So clinically, you have to differentiate whether it is due to rheumatoid arthritis or due to rheumatic arthritis. Usually in case of rheumatic arthritis, duration will be very short, like 1 day or 2 days, or within 1 week only. Very short duration of illness will be there in rheumatic arthritis. But in case of rheumatoid arthritis, it is a history will be long duration, like for few weeks. It will be there for few weeks. Sometimes it will be more than 6 weeks also for definition to call it as juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Previously used to call as juvenile rheumatoid arthritis. Both are same. But old name is, previously they used to call it as juvenile rheumatoid arthritis. Recently now we are calling it as juvenile idiopathic arthritis. You should not be confused. JA or JRA, both are same. Rheumatoid arthritis, usually long duration history will be there, like for few weeks. In case of rheumatic arthritis, it will be for few days. Very short duration, acute onset will be there. Not only that, involvement of joints. Usually, juvenile rheumatoid arthritis or juvenile idiopathic arthritis involves the large joint, but there are variants which can also affect the small joints. But rheumatic arthritis always affects large joints only. Rheumatic, that is in case of rheumatic fever with arthritis, that is called as rheumatic arthritis, affects the large joints, and that too in migratory fashion. Like for example, first day they may have right knee joint pain. Second or third day they may get pain of left elbow joint. By that time, usually pain in the right knee joint will be decreased. That's what we call as fleeting type of arthritis or migratory arthritis in case of rheumatic arthritis. Okay, because we have to differentiate between both rheumatoid arthritis and rheumatic fever associated arthritis in clinical history or clinical case scenarios in practice, in your daily practice. And not only that, there will be history of morning stiffness in case of JIA, that is juvenile idiopathic arthritis or juvenile rheumatoid arthritis. But in case of arthritis associated with rheumatic fever, that is rheumatic arthritis, there won't be any history of morning stiffness. So morning stiffness usually favors towards the juvenile idiopathic arthritis or juvenile rheumatoid arthritis. Okay. Other differences are like deformities are common in which condition? Is it in rheumatic arthritis or rheumatoid arthritis? Joint deformities, joint erosion, all destruction, joint destruction are more common in rheumatoid arthritis or idiopathic arthritis, juvenile idiopathic arthritis. No deformity or no damage to the joints in case of rheumatic fever with arthritis or rheumatic arthritis. Okay, these differences. And not only that, pain will be very severe and acute in rheumatic fever, and that subsides within 24 to 48 hours of NSAIDs intake. If doctor gives some NSAID like ibuprofen, they will get rid of pain severe, that much severe pain within 24 to 48 hours. But response to treatment will be very quick in case of rheumatic fever, and in case of rheumatoid arthritis or idiopathic arthritis, they have to use NSAIDs for weeks, then only they will get some relief, not complete relief. So that's the differences between rheumatoid arthritis and rheumatic arthritis or juvenile idiopathic arthritis and arthritis associated with rheumatic fever or rheumatic arthritis. Those fundamentals you should remember whenever you get a case of arthritis case or joint pain case. So today's class, we will know what is the definition of juvenile idiopathic arthritis and what is the classification of ILAR, means International League Against Rheumatic rheumatology classification and clinical approach to a case with joint pains or arthritis, whether it's fasci articular or polyarticular, and investigations. What are the investigations are required to diagnose the particular type of juvenile idiopathic arthritis and management principles. So coming to the definition of JEA, usually they will ask juvenile idiopathic arthritis, or sometimes they may call it as juvenile rheumatoid arthritis, but you should remember this recent nomenclature is juvenile idiopathic arthritis. To call as juvenile idiopathic arthritis, arthritis which should begin before the 16th birthday of the child. We should be before 16th birthday, and it has no known cause. That's why we call as idiopathic. That means no identifiable cause should be there, like reactive arthritis, or like rheumatic fever with arthritis, or tuberculosis arthritis, septic arthritis, like that. Those should not be any cause for arthritis. Then only we call as juvenile idiopathic arthritis, and it should last for more than 6 weeks. Duration should be more. For ideal definition, it should be more than 6 weeks. And diagnosis, it's actually like diagnosis of exclusion. You should rule out tuberculosis arthritis or septic. In case of oligoarthritis, you should rule out the septic arthritis and all those conditions. It's like a diagnosis of exclusion. And incidence of juvenile idiopathic arthritis is 10 per 1 lakh children. Next, coming to the classification, that is International League Against Rheumatology classification of JEA. That is juvenile idiopathic arthritis. There are mainly six types, that is systemic arthritis, polyarthritis, oligoarthritis, enthesitis related arthritis, psoriatic arthritis, undifferentiated arthritis. Okay, again, polyarthritis is divided into rheumatoid, depending on the rheumatoid factor positivity or negativity, two types, rheumatoid factor negative and rheumatoid factor positive. Oligoarthritis, again, persistent oligoarthritis and oligoarthritis, extended oligoarthritis. First, initially it will be like oligoarthritis, then it progresses to polyarthritis. So persistent means it initially starts as oligoarthritis and it will be like oligoarthritis only. There won't be any multiple joint involvement. But if it is started as oligoarthritis and turn up into polyarthritis, then we call as extended oligoarthritis. Enthesitis related arthritis, psoriatic arthritis, and undifferentiated arthritis. That means it is not fitting to any category. Sometimes it may fit into more than one category. Like enthesitis related features will be there, and also polyarthritis or psoriatic arthritis features. Then we call as undifferentiated arthritis fits more than one category. This is the recent classification of ILAR classification.
Ma'am, what is meant by enthesitis?
Enthesitis means where the tendon attaches to the bone. That place inflammation we call as enthesitis. Usually there will be tenderness and pain at the site of insertion of the ligaments to the bone. That place inflammation we call as enthesitis. Usually ankle joint, tendon or ligament attached to the bony point, there inflammation we call as enthesitis. Most commonly example is like, for example, ankle joint. So at this junction of ligament attaching to the bone, a tendon attaching to the bone, there will be inflammation, that is enthesitis. Okay. And what are the parameters? What are the parameters used to classify this classification? That is International League Against Rheumatology classification. Presence of objective arthritis. Arthritis usually should be objective in case of JEA. Objective means not only the patient, the doctor or other person also should feel the features of inflammation. Arthralgia means there won't be any signs of inflammation. Only pain in the joints will be there. That's very common with even viral fevers and all those conditions. We may child or the person may have arthralgia. So arthralgia is a subjective. Arthritis is should be objective. That means it should, you should feel the signs of inflammation like swelling, redness, warmth. All features should be there. Then only we call as objective arthritis. So there should be presence of objective arthritis. And depending on the site of inflammation, whether the large joints are involved, small joints are involved, peripheral joints are involved, axial skeleton is involved, or enthesitis. Is it associated with enthesitis, like at the attachment of ligaments or tendons to the bone, that part inflammation we call as enthesitis. Duration of objective arthritis. There should be, duration should be clear also. As I told you, there should be more than 6 weeks duration, then only by the time we have to explore the other conditions. Meanwhile, during that time, we have to explore other rheumatic arthritis or septic arthritis or tuberculosis arthritis or reactive arthritis, and all those conditions we have to exclude. Still, child is having arthritis features, not responding to, unless it's quickly, then we will go for the diagnosis of juvenile idiopathic arthritis. And systemic disease, usually features of systemic disease, they will be typical feature, fever, leptospirometry, anemia, all those features will be there in case of systemic disease. And lab findings like ANA, that is, what is ANA? Anti-nuclear antibodies, rheumatoid factors, HLA, B27, these will be positive or negative depending upon that also. We will classify JA into different classifications. And whether it's affected the female gender and male gender. So some types are common in boys and some are common in girls. Progranulation joint involvement, limited or extended to oligoarthritis. As I told you, only started as oligoarthritis, only particular, only it's acting like oligoarthritis. But it started as oligoarthritis, involving the more joints, then we call it as extended oligoarthritis. Other system involvement, other GIT, respiratory and eyes, after like anti-uveitis and growth retardation, other features also will be there. That's more common in systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Family history of certain diseases like spondyloarthropathy or psoriasis leading to psoriatic arthritis. Onset of age, is it before 7 years, after 7 years, ideally should be less than 16th birthday. So these features will give you a clue to diagnose and classify the juvenile idiopathic arthritis. So coming to the individual types, oligoarthritis. Juvenile oligoarthritis, juvenile idiopathic arthritis is 40 to 50% of all juvenile idiopathic arthritis constitutes the oligoarthritis type. Most common in young girls. Sometimes it can affect the boys also, but common in girls only. Large joint involvement, especially can observe, and predominantly lower limbs. So they can't sometimes, young children, as it is common in young girls, they can't tell about the pain or tenderness, but you can observe the signs of inflammation, and child will be limping. They sometimes is reluctant to move also. So limp will be there, predominantly lower limbs. Frequent chronic cantilupity is the complication, and the eye and joint disease sometimes may simultaneously evolve or independent level. That's why if you suspecting a child with juvenile idiopathic arthritis, always regular checkup with ophthalmology specialist should be there to explore the anteriority. If you won't diagnose and if you won't treat, the child may become blind also. So should be very careful with oligoarthritis. And anti-nuclear antibodies are positive in 40 to 75% of these type of cases. And usually oligoarthritis may be confused with septic arthritis. Sometimes oligoarthritis type of tuberculosis arthritis can manifest with oligoarthritis or generalized arthritis also, multiple polyarthritis also. Systemic onset juvenile idiopathic arthritis. It's less common than oligoarthritis. 10 to 20% of all juvenile idiopathic arthritis will be systemic onset juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Almost equal in both sexes. Both boys and girls may be affected. And mean age is around 4 to 6 years. Very young age. It can present at 4 to 6 years of age. And if you go for HLA typing, HLA DR5, DR8, and DR4 may be positive. And the child looks very sick. And they will have fever, quotidian type of fever. That means peak will be there in every day. And it touches the baseline also. That's why it's called as quotidian. Every day, fever will be there. So quotidian type goes below and sometimes touches the baseline, and child well in between the spikes without fever. And reticular endothelial system involvement will be there. Can manifest with leptospirometry and anemia, serositis, serosal involvement. And mostly they develop in the first 3 months. Arthritis, 50% develop chronic erosive arthritis. Erosive means they can lead to deformities and joint destruction also. It's very typical of systemic arthritis. The child had this type of systemic arthritis, they may have neck stiffness, they can't move their neck, that's it. This can lead to feeding difficulties, they can't play also. So this will be very, they can't move, they will be bedridden. All those problems will be there with systemic arthritis. And there may be rash, that is evanescent salmon pink colored rash. Usually trunk and lower trunk and the limbs will be affected with maybe urticarial associated with or without pruritus. That is itching. Okay, one more thing is for systemic arthritis, you have to know that this can lead to growth retardation because of the disease itself or maybe due to drugs. Usually we commonly use steroids. So that can also can lead to growth retardation. So chronic uses of steroids can lead to growth retardation, cataracts and glaucoma, all those complications. And child will be very sick looking, deformities, joint deformities and distraction. Sometimes they may need joint replacement also. That much severe problem is there in systemic onset juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Next, coming to the polyarticular juvenile idiopathic arthritis, the five or more joint and joints are involved, we call this polyarticular juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Usually these children will be RF, that means rheumatoid factor negative and rheumatoid factor positive. Rheumatoid factor negative girls, it's common in girls and usually around 3 years of age. Systemic large and small joint both symmetrically involves the large and small joints. And for example, hip joint, temporomandibular joint, cervical spine may be involved. Extra-articular features are low-grade fever. They may have low-grade fever. And antinuclear antibodies are positive in 40% of the cases. And ESR, WBC count moderately elevated. But in systemic onset, usually they will have high ESR values and rise to WBC count and CRP also positive. Genetics for HLA typing, BRB1 will be positive. If you can remember, otherwise genetics, okay, but other features you should remember. It's most common in girls, age more than 3 years, symmetrical, large and small joints, both will be involved. So can you observe here? So child is not able to open the mouth more than this because of temporomandibular joint involvement. So they can't take food properly. This also can lead to growth retardation. Next, polyarticular type of juvenile idiopathic arthritis, rheumatoid factor positive. This is also, here also female children are more predominantly involved, but here age is 10 years plus. RF negative, very young age, like 3 years plus. RF positive, that is rheumatoid factor positive, 10 years plus. However, may begin at any early age, but here also symmetrical small joints, especially hand and foot, this is more common, followed by large joints. There may be vasculitic features, rheumatoid nodules, pulmonary disease, as described in adults, can also be seen in case of rheumatoid factor positive polyarticular juvenile idiopathic arthritis. This is very progressive, aggressive and erosive disease. You can observe here in the photograph, Swan neck deformity. Deformities in case of juvenile idiopathic arthritis, there is so many deformities and destruction of joints will take permanent deformity. This is not temporary. Once deformity occurs, we have to, in case of large joints, very debilitating illness, joint replacement only. So like this will happen in case of rheumatoid arthritis, especially polyarticular juvenile idiopathic arthritis, rheumatoid factor positive. But in case of rheumatic fever, there won't be any deformity or erosion, but pain will be very severe in rheumatic fever with short history. That's one of the differential features of rheumatic fever and rheumatoid arthritis. Next, coming to the enthesitis related arthritis. So arthritis plus, they can manifest with arthritis plus enthesitis or only arthritis. Later they may develop enthesitis or both may be there. So you can hear, usually there will be tenderness of the tendon attachment to the bone or ligamental attachment to the bone, both there will be tenderness and pain also. So most common joints involve sacroiliac joint tenderness and are inflammatory spinal pain. These are the associated features of enthesitis related arthritis. And HLA B27 will be positive. Family history of HLA B27 also may be associated with this disease. Okay. So they will have pain in the sole arches at the where there will be attachment of ligaments and tendons to the bone. So may have pain, tenderness here, here, and here. Acute anterior uveitis is very commonly associated with NSAIDs related arthritis. Onset of arthritis is more common in boys and more than 8 years of age. Exoskeletal involvement unusual in children. It's more common in adults, like spine problems, but may be seen in adolescents. Next, psoriatic arthritis. Psoriatic arthritis, arthritis and psoriasis features both will be there. It can simultaneously appear, or sometimes maybe they may present with arthritis first. And our arthritis by family history of psoriasis. So family history of arthritis may or may not be there, but family history of psoriasis, but child may have features of arthritis. And with at least one of the following, like dactylitis, inflammation of the fingers, dactylitis. And nail abnormalities means they may have pitted nails. Psoriasis, in psoriasis you can observe pitting of the nails. That also you can observe. So nail abnormalities like pitted nails or dactylitis, anyone associated with family history of psoriasis or arthritis, with arthritis we may think about psoriatic arthritis. So HLA-B27 association is not associated with this, and spinal inflammatory disease is very rare. So enthesitis related arthritis, there will be spinal involvement, axial involvement, well, unusual in children, but may have, especially in adults, they can't bend. They usually have early morning spinal stiffness, lower back pain. So they will be reluctant to play out, those children. So this further deteriorates the condition of the child again, because of the morning stiffness and this spinal stiffness, they will have lower back pain. They won't show any interest in the playing, but we have to give counseling. So what is the treatment modality? How will you treat mainly these juvenile idiopathic arthritis? It's a multidisciplinary, not only drugs. Like NSAIDs won't give 100% relief, as I told you. In case of rheumatic fever associated arthritis, that is rheumatic arthritis, if you give any NSAID, usually by 24 to 48 hours, the child will walk without any pain. That much dramatic response will be there. Usually, the parents or attendants will get the child in a wheelchair, sometimes in hands, severe multiple joint pains. Even touching of the cloth or bed sheet also they can't allow in case of rheumatic arthritis. With a short history, if you give some NSAIDs, usually and next day they will walk and run like a normal children. But in case of rheumatic arthritis, pain will be severe, but not much severe as in rheumatic arthritis, but it won't respond to NSAIDs. Whatever NSAIDs you give, it takes time, few weeks to even months also to get rid of this pain. So this is a multidisciplinary approach. Mainly physiotherapy and occupational therapy is very, very important. As I told you, these joint involvement can lead to erosions and deformities. So there needs physiotherapy and sometimes surgery also. Surgical correction needed in case of deformities, and especially knee joint erosion. Sometimes they may need joint replacement also. And early stages we can use NSAIDs, that is non-steroid anti-inflammatory drugs like example, anybody? What NSAIDs we will use in juvenile idiopathic arthritis or juvenile rheumatoid arthritis? I think it's a long case. Sometimes you may get as essay for theory in case of general medicine. In pediatrics, you may get as a essay question, but short case, or sometimes they will ask a differential diagnosis for rheumatic arthritis, rheumatic fever with arthritis case is there, then they will ask how will you differentiate between rheumatoid arthritis and rheumatic arthritis. Then they will go like that. Sometimes arthritis, unexplained idiopathic arthritis, not at labeled as juvenile idiopathic arthritis, because to label as juvenile idiopathic arthritis takes time. You have to exclude other conditions and it should be more than 6 weeks duration. So NSAIDs like ibuprofen and naproxen, we can use it. Be loud, I am unable to hear. Somebody is asking some doubt. Are answering.
Celecoxib, ma'am.
Okay. Next, but they may have NSAIDs, especially they may have side effects like GI upset, gastritis, bleeding tendency, although the liver damage may be that we have to keep in our mind. And DM means disease modifying anti-rheumatoid drugs. Examples? Anybody? You should read this topic for both general medicine and pediatrics. No? It's more common in general medicine than in pediatrics group. But you may get question in general medicine or pediatrics in theory and practicals also. What is disease? What are the disease modifying anti-rheumatoid drugs? You know, just tell some drugs.
Methotrexate.
Methotrexate. Anything else? So methotrexate, any side effects are there for methotrexate? It can damage the liver also, methotrexate. Huh? So methotrexate and the biological agents like tumor necrosis factor blockers and monoclonal antibodies like rituximab and anakinra, these drugs can be used like trials. So usually, is there anything like we can prevent juvenile idiopathic arthritis to occur? Any preventive measures are there? So there is no preventive measures. There is no cause identified. That's why it is called as juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Once a child affected, we have to after seeing the clinical history carefully and with some help with the lab, like there may be CRP post to ESR will be raised, WBC counts will be raised, tumor rheumatoid factor may be positive in some conditions, maybe negative anti-nuclear antibodies, but X-rays to explore the other condition, X-rays and MRA skeletal to explore the other conditions like infection and tumors or fractures. For that purpose only we will go for the X-rays and MRA of the spine. Otherwise, it's mainly clinically and some laboratory evidence, HLA typing and all those we can do. Okay, so proper history, family history also important, especially is there any history of arthritis in the family and also psoriatic features are there in the family leads to classification. Depending upon that, prognosis depends. Why you should classify, why you have to classify this thing as ILA classification, why it is important? Mainly in case of systemic arthritis, it affects the multiple other systems also affected and the child growth will be affected. All those features will be there. Polyarthritis, alkarthritis, usually recovery will be very far, almost 50 to 60% alkarthritis will recover. Polyarthritis around 40 to 50%. To give the prognosis, we need this classification, International League Against Rheumatology classification. So, psoriatic arthritis, if you treat the psoriasis usually along with some supportive therapy, anti-inflammatory and pain therapy for arthritis, recovery will be good. To, for that systemic arthritis, prognosis will be very bad with multiple joints involvement and deformities. And especially there will be anemia, associated anemia and other effects, splenomegaly. All those complications are more common with systemic arthritis. That's why for prognosis purpose, we need classification. Any doubts? Main thing, what is juvenile idiopathic arthritis, you should know. What is the recent classification of juvenile idiopathic arthritis, you should know. And what are the clinical features of different arthritis? How will you differentiate between other types of arthritis? And physiotherapy, especially very, very important. Main role is here, physiotherapy. Because otherwise, it joint stiffness, they can't move, and it further increases the deformity and erosion. So physiotherapy, especially warm baths, and especially they can go for swimming, those type of exercises are needed, and occupational therapy for them is more important, physiotherapy and exercises. So morning stiffness will be there, but we have to counsel them for if there is exercise, they can do exercise, we can prevent the deformities in the early stages itself, not in the late stages. So early stages, physiotherapy plays a key role in managing the juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Any doubts? Anybody is having any doubts regarding juvenile idiopathic arthritis? You can read from the OP guide also. I told you gist of the classification, what are the main clinical features to differentiate among the different types. This is the recent classification what I told. Any doubts? If there are no doubts, I'm going to close the class. Okay, thank you very much. If anybody is having any doubts, if you get a question for 10 marks or 4 marks, can you answer or not? Okay. No doubts, I will close, end the meeting.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Attendance, Papa, attendance, please, Punava.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.